Hello friends, welcome to webinar number 3 about basic chess interpretation. Let's go to the first case. The case number 1 belongs to a 24-year-old man asymptomatic with occasional fainting spells, and I'm offering you a PHS film. And as usual, our first question should be, is the chess normal or abnormal? And in case you find it abnormal, I'm going to offer you 2 options. In which zone do you see the findings? Is it in the superior, is it in the middle, inferior one, or you cannot tell? And now, with this, I suggest that you stop the presentation, look carefully at the PHS film, and when you are sure of your diagnosis, come back to the presentation. Well, we are back, and the abnormality to me is very obvious. There is convexity of the right side of the middle portion of the mediastinum. Normally, this is identified as dilatation of the ascending aorta, which is the most common cause of this abnormality. So the answer is the lesion is in the middle mediastinum. Some of you in the blog has diagnosed this abnormality as a dilatation of the ascending aorta secondary to coartation. And that is wrong because I don't see any rib notching, and also the aortic knob is completely unremarkable. Given the age of the patient, the most likely diagnosis is probably stenosis of the aortic valve, congenital stenosis, and we see a reconstruction of an enhanced CT, and we see the dilatation of the ascending aorta, confirming what we see in the plain film, and heavy calcification in the aortic valve. In axial view, we see a malformed and calcified aortic valve, and the final diagnosis is what we suspected, congenital aortic valve stenosis with post-stenotic dilatation. I'm presenting this case to continue with the exploration of the middle area of the lung. In the past webinar, we talked about the hyla, left and right hyla, and the abnormalities. And now I want to talk about the mediastinal contour. There is an important fact we have to know, that the middle mediastinum is occupied mainly by the aorta and the pulmonary artery. So any abnormality in this middle zone should be supposed to be due to an arterial abnormality, either of the aorta or the pulmonary artery. We're going to study mainly 3 zones: the zone of the right middle mediastinum, the zone of the aortic knob, and the middle mediastinum on the left, which corresponds to the pulmonary artery. There are 2 areas I'm not going to talk about because I don't have the time, but one is the azygos arch, which was described and well studied in the diploma number 56, and the aortopulmonary window that was described and was studied recently in the diploma 144. So I recommend that you go to these 2 diplomas to complete the study of the middle mediastinal zone. With this, let's go to case number 2, the PHS radiograph belongs to a 49-year-old woman with dyspnea and is grossly abnormal, as you can see. And I'm giving you 4 possible diagnoses. The changes are due to a lymphoma. They are due to pulmonary arterial hypertension. Is metastatic disease to the hyla? Or if you cannot make up your mind, you may answer for any of the above. Again, stop the presentation. Study carefully the film and then come back when you are ready with your diagnosis. Okay, we are back. And now I'm going to show the abnormalities to you. In the first moment, and I'm sorry, the first thing that we see is a right aortic arch, which is a common anomaly. And the most important thing is marked convexity of the pulmonary arch segment, accompanied by a large right hilum and an even larger left hilum or left pulmonary artery. And those findings are accompanied as well by a diminished pulmonary vasculature. And the thing I just said, convex pulmonary artery, enlarged hilum or enlarged pulmonary arteries, right and left pulmonary arteries, and limited vasculature in the periphery of the lung are the hallmark of pulmonary arterial hypertension. So that will be a diagnosis we have to offer, number two here. And in the lateral view, we confirm that what we are seeing in the PR lateral view are no lymph nodes, but the right and left pulmonary arteries, one anterior and the one posterior to the axis of the trachea. We confirm the diagnosis with the clinical examination, of course, clinical test, and with the CT. This is a markedly enlarged main pulmonary artery compared to the size of the artery of the aorta, right pulmonary artery, left pulmonary artery. You see also that in the coronal reconstruction, see the right pulmonary arch on the in the upper portion. Okay, so final diagnosis is pulmonary artery hypertension. In this patient, it was secondary to Eisenbanger syndrome in the patient with tetralogy of Fallot, and the patient was diagnosed of pink Fallot during the infancy, and for some reason it was not operated on, and that's what he ended with. Okay, I want to talk first about the pulmonary artery. Pulmonary artery is drawn over here. You see the main pulmonary artery crosses the mediastinum and then ends up in the right pulmonary artery, which is the right hilum, left pulmonary artery, which is the left hilum. The thing is, most of the pulmonary artery are the branches are not seen until they go out into the lung and they are outlined by air. So we miss most of the arterial abnormalities of the pulmonary artery. And what we see, the only thing that we see is this area, this small area, which represent the outer border of the main pulmonary artery. We can see that in the axial CT, that is the only part of the main pulmonary artery that is outlined by air. And that's the only part that we see. And from the semiologic point of view, all we see is convexity of this arch. But still, even if it's a very little to have, you can have important diagnosis, or you can make important diagnosis just by looking at this area. Let's see, for example, we have a 43-year-old woman with dyspnea. At the first glance, the heart is a little bit enlarged, but the most important finding is an obvious convexity of the pulmonary artery arch. And that indicates dilatation of the pulmonary artery, or the main pulmonary artery. When we see that, we have to go and look at the hilum. This one is enlarged. The left one is hidden behind the pulmonary artery. And we look also at the pulmonary vasculature, which is diminished. We don't see any significantly enlarged vessels either in the lower or the upper lobe. And the same thing happened on the left side. And we have the combination that we mentioned before. Enlarged pulmonary artery, main pulmonary artery, enlarged hilum, and poor circulation in the lungs is practically pathognomonic of pulmonary arterial hypertension. And that should be our diagnosis in the brain film, which of course should be confirmed with other procedures. In the lateral view, we can see again that the hilum are enlarged in the PA, and I'm sorry, in the lateral view in the right artery and the left artery are no signs of any other abnormality. This is a typical pulmonary arterial hypertension, and this is one of the conditions, the most common conditions, that we are going to find in the Plensch's film when we see convexity of the pulmonary artery segment. There are other two conditions that we have to know about. This is, by the way, this is the CT of the patient showing the disparity between the size of the aorta and the size of the pulmonary artery that measures almost 35 millimeters. And you know that 29 millimeters in diameter is a maximum diameter of the pulmonary artery until we call it normal, abnormal, sorry. As I said, there are many causes of pulmonary arterial hypertension. I selected here the most common, in my opinion. By far, the most common one is secondary to pulmonary disease, and chronic obstructive bronchopulmonary disease is the most common one. But any diffuse lung disease may end up with the pulmonary arterial hypertension. Second, we have congenital heart disease, which is called Eisenmenger syndrome, which is a reversal of a left to right shunt. Idiopathic, if you work in hospitals, you are going to see a few of these. There is no, is a congenital disease, has no reason, but that's why it's called idiopathic, and occurs in young adults and usually females. And then you have chronic pulmonary embolism by increased peripheral resistance. And all cases look similar on plain films regardless of the cause. Of course, if you see severe pulmonary disease, either COPD or other cause, then you think the hypertension is secondary to pulmonary disease. If you see some problems some problems in the costophrenic angles, then you think the patient may have chronic pulmonary embolism. But you have, as I say, all look similar, and you had to take other tests and other studies to make the final diagnosis. But you suspect pulmonary arterial hypertension of any cause with the plain film. See, here we have a nice example of pulmonary arterial hypertension in pulmonary disease in a 44-year-old woman with Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Has some diffuse problem, ill-defined abnormalities, not really clear pattern, but what is clear, it has an obvious convexity of the pulmonary artery segment, large hilla, right, the left hidden. You can see there the diameter of the main arteries, and very scarce, very limited vascularity in the periphery, typical signs of pulmonary arterial hypertension. CT will demonstrate the diffuse affectation of the lungs and the marked increase in size of the pulmonary artery compared to the aorta, sign of pulmonary arterial hypertension. I say there are three causes of convexity of the pulmonary artery arch. This is a second. The first one is pulmonary arterial hypertension. This is a one. The patient with, again, obvious convexity of the pulmonary artery arch. The hilla is not small, perhaps a little bit enlarged, but there is increased circulation in the lung, mostly here in the lower lobe. There you see the size of the arteries going to the upper lobe. So here we have convexity. Every all of them have convexities. Hilla, normal or large, and increased pulmonary circulation. This is very suggestive. Oh, sorry, that is the patient has an unrelated goiter. I didn't want to confuse you. This is pathognomonic of a left to right shunt, which may occur too in the adult population and be more or less asymptomatic if it occurs at atrial level, because if it is at the ventricular level, usually gives symptoms in childhood. This patient MRI, sagittal MRI, demonstrate the shunt at the level of the left atrium, at the area that joins the left atrium at the right atrium, and you can see the mark, is important shunt mark with a red arrow, and it happened to be a septum secundum atrial septal defect with left to right shunt. So that's the second condition that produces convexity of the pulmonary artery segment. And the third condition is here. This is a preoperative radiograph in a 54-year-old man, asymptomatic. And what we see here, again, convexity of the pulmonary arch, a normal left hilum, an enlarged left hilum. This is very typical, should be diagnosed or tentatively diagnosed as the pulmonary valve stenosis. You have the convexity of the pulmonary artery because of the jet of blood dilates the pulmonary artery, and when we see the left, I'm sorry, when we see the CT of the pulmonary artery, see the large convexity, and also the jet also hits the left pulmonary artery. That's why we have this combination: convexity of the main pulmonary artery, enlarged left artery, normal right artery, because it's away from the jet. And this is a third condition that makes you, or make us, suspect a pulmonary valve stenosis that was proven in this patient that was asymptomatic and was ignorant of his condition. Pitfall. It is normal to see prominent pulmonary arch in teenagers. That is a common finding and is probably due to thymic tissue, and shouldn't be suspected of an abnormality. So in anybody under 25 with this finding, call it normal and do not worry about that. And the other possibility, the other possible pitfall, is that we have a tumor in this area, in front or behind the pulmonary artery, that may simulate a pulmonary artery segment convexity. You see that there, very similar to the cases that that I showed before, but it was due to a thymoma that was is a not enhanced CT because was done immediately after this X-ray was taken. The patient was asymptomatic. And after that was proven to be a thymoma. So in conclusion, this part, in convexity of the pulmonary artery segment, first, very easy to diagnose if we know where to look. And if it is accompanied by big hyla and scarce vessels, diagnose, the tentative diagnosis, pulmonary artery, hypertension. If the hyla are normal and the vessels are normal to increase, suggest a left to right shunt. And if there is convexity with a large left hilum, your diagnosis should be, tentative diagnosis, should be pulmonary valve stenosis. I'm sorry, I have to apologize because this is I consider this is a boring lecture, because the semiology, the findings are very limited. All you are going to see is convexity of one part of the mediastinum or another. But still, the conclusions you can draw from this convexity are very important. And you can make important and significant tentative diagnosis. Okay. Now let's go to case number three. It's a 75-year-old man with chest pain. Look at the chest. It's obviously abnormal. And I'm going you for possibility. The most likely diagnosis will be 1, aortic aneurysm, 2, aortic coartation, 3, aortic valve stenosis, or if you cannot make up your mind, think of or answer any of the above. Stop the presentation, look carefully at the radiograph, and come back with your diagnosis. Okay, we are back. And the obvious abnormality is convexity of the ascending aorta, of the right mediastinum of the middle right mediastinum, middle part of the mediastinum. Okay, so aortic aneurysma is okay. Aortic coarctation, it is not, because we don't see any abnormality in the aortic arch. We don't see any figure of three of any of the abnormality. We don't see any rib notching, so we exclude that. But it could be an aortic valve stenosis. But if we look carefully, we have an indication that help us to make the correct diagnosis. We see a calcification here in the periphery of the aorta, and also we see a coarse calcification in the inner part of the aorta. So this and that indicate that the aorta is markedly dilated. So our first diagnosis should be aortic aneurysm. And we see that even better in the lateral view. We see this time in this projection, we see the marked dilatation of the descending aorta, given the age of the patient, which is 75, a probable diagnosis is atherosclerotic aortic aneurysm. We do a CT, non-enhanced CT, we see already dilatation of the root of the aorta, and when we inject contrast, we see the marked dilatation of the aortic root in the sagittal and the coronal projection. So our suspicion is confirmed, and the final diagnosis is atherosclerotic aneurysm. I'm putting this case to discuss the ascending aorta, convexity of the ascending aorta. The aorta varies from a young person to an old person. In a young person, the aorta is not visible because it's hidden by the mediastinal tissues, and the only thing that we see is the aortic knob, which is usually very small. In an old person, the aorta dilates, elongates, and then we can see clearly the ascending aorta, and we see clearly the descending aorta. Remember that the main part of the aorta is hidden in the mediastinum, so we only see the outline. We see the outline of the ascending aorta, and we see the outline of the descending aorta, and especially we see the aortic knob. The point I want to make is, in the old person, when the aorta dilates or elongates, as a whole. So we have elongation, we have projection, or we have convexity of the right part, the aortic knob, and the descending aorta. If we see dilatation of only one part, either the right part, the descending aorta, or the left part, the aortic knob or descending aorta, then we have to suspect that there is something wrong. That happened with this young person who has an obvious dilatation of the ascending aorta and a normal aortic knob and descending aorta. So therefore, this thing abnormal. So we suspect the dilatation of the ascending aorta. And the findings, as I said before, are very monotonous, but when we do a CT, but we have to do a CT, of course, we see a large dilatation of the descending aorta and a normal descending aorta, as we suspected from the playing field. And this is a 18-year-old male with Marfan syndrome and aneurysm of ascending aorta, that you know happens in Marfans. As I said, the findings are rather monotonous because we have four conditions that give convexity of ascending aorta. Aortic valve stenosis that we saw, aneurysm of any cause, we saw a atherosclerotic aneurysm, and here we are seeing a Marfan. Type A aortic dissection also will give dilatation of the ascending aorta, and then aortic coarctation. Those are the four conditions that you had to think of when looking at this convexity. And of these four, the only one that we can suggest in the aortic, in the plain film, is aortic coarctation. Why? Because in aortic coarctation, we not only see convexity of the ascending aorta, but we see abnormalities of the aortic knob. Most common is a figure of three that we don't see in this case, but we see another sign which is very important, which is blurring of the top of the knob. See, the knob is practically doesn't have the normal appearance. The top is missing because the dilated left subclavian artery, which is collateral circulation, acts as the collateral circulation, blurs, because of the silhouette sign, blurs the top of the knob. And we can see that nicely here in the MRI of the aorta. See, aortic knob, the upper portion is blurred by the dilated left subclavian artery. That's why we don't see it in the PAFM. You can see also confirm the dilatation of the ascending aorta. That is the only sign that we see in the plain film. That's aortic coartation. There is a pitfall in these cases, a mediastinal mass. We are common in this area, but still you can have a mediastinal mass, the same thing that we have on the left side, mimicking the pulmonary artery, the convexity of the pulmonary artery. Here we have a mediastinal lesion, mimicking a dilatation of the ascending aorta. This is a postoperative radiograph after surgery in carcinoma of the left lobe. We have seen here the postoperative changes. This is abnormal. We have to do a CT. When we do a CT, we see fluid in the bed of the tumor has been operated on, and also we see fluid in the paramediastinal region secondary to dissection or lymph node in the plain film simulating ascending aorta. A very important negative findings, as I mentioned before, is seeing one portion of the aorta dilated and the other not. This is what is called the missing ascending aorta in aortic elongation. When the aorta elongates, we are supposed to have the whole aorta elongated. In this case, we only have the descending aorta, and we don't have the right aorta, the ascending aorta. There is something missing. When you see this combination, no ascending aorta, undilated descending aorta, you have to suspect in the plain film a type B dissection. Not all the time you are going to be right, but sometimes, not sometimes, I'd say 50% of the time, you are going to be able to make the diagnosis and confirm it with a CT. This is a CT of this patient, normal ascending aorta, enlarged descending aorta with a nice dissection. In the sagittal view, the same thing, normal ascending aorta, dissection, starting in the descending aorta and with the normal lumen and the dissected lumen. Nicely diagnosed, nicely suspected in the plain film. Remember that because it's going to help you either in your clinical practice or if you are taking an examination. So, summarizing the second part, causes of isolated dilatation of the ascending aorta, aortic valve stenosis, aneurysm, type A dissection, and aortic coartation. This aortic coartation is the only one that you can suggest in the plain film with some feeability. Let's go now to case number 4. This is a 46-year-old woman operated of liposarcoma 6 years ago. This PHS film looks, to me at least, looks very normal, although it is not. And I'm going to give you 4 options. Is there abnormality in the middle mediastinum? Is there abnormality in the hilum? Is there abnormality in the aortic knob? Or you can tell. Stop the presentation. Look at this case carefully, very carefully, because there is a subtle finding here. And then come back to the presentation. Okay. Well, now I can tell you that the case is obviously abnormal if you look at the aortic knob. Because when we look at the knob, we see a double contour. This is normal knob, and this is a second contour projected over it. When you see that, you have to think of a mediastinal mass projected over the aortic knob, either in front or behind it. There you see a condom view, you must see much better the 2 lines of the of the double contour of the aortic node. Of course, you are supposed to do a CT. In this particular case, MRI was done. There we see a posterior mediastinal mass that in a normal patient, a patient without antecedents, will be a neurogenic tumor. It said that this patient has the antecedents of liposarcoma, and the MRI was done, and you see not only a mediastinal, posterior mediastinal mass, but affectation, invasion of the vertebral body. And unfortunately for the patient, that happens to be metastasis from liposarcoma, detected only in the plain film because this simple finding, a double contour of the aortic node. And looking at the aortic node is very important. This is the basic symbiology of the aortic node. First, you had to look at the size and you had to look at the contour, nothing else, only two things. The size, if it is increased, is isolated, increased size of the node, is very, very obvious because it's an aortic arch aneurysm, and you can confirm that with an enhanced CT. The contour, you had to look at three things. First, the double contour, which you measured, we already mentioned. Second, the figure of three signs, which is practically pathognomonic of coartation. And third, the aortic nipple. The figure of three is very typical. You see that, and is secondary to the notch that causes the coartation. It's very, very obvious. There you have another coartation with a figure of three there on the notch. And again, has this blurring here that this is good, very good sign to diagnose aortic coartation if you don't see very well the figure of three, because again, this is secondary to the dilated left subclavian artery. In asymptomatic patient with an aortic arch without hypertension, you have to think of pseudocoartation. You have a pseudocoartation here with a nice figure of three, but the patient was asymptomatic and has no hypertension. This is caused by congenital kinking of the aortic arch without narrowing of obstruction. And this is an unusual disease, unusual process, but I have seen a few along my life, and I'm sure you, if you look for it, you are going to see it too. And the final abnormality of the contour of the aortic arch is the aortic nipple. It's called like that because it looks like a nipple in a breast in the aortic arch. And this is secondary to the left superior intercostal vein that crosses around the aortic arch, the aortic node. And it gives this so-called nipple, and it happens in between 5 and 10% of the population, and is a normal finding. The abnormal finding is when the nipple is increased in size, as you can see over there, we have a nipple markedly enlarged, and this is abnormal, and you can confirm that with CT. There you have the aortic arch, and you have the enlarged left superior intercostal vein, and here in the axial view, again, the enlarged left superior intercostal vein going around the aorta, and you can compare the diameter of this vein with this one, which is completely different. This is an important sign because this corresponds to the azygos, hemiazygos system, and they act as a draining system when there is obstruction either of the superior or the inferior vena cava. So you see an aortic nipple and an enlarged azygos vein, as you see over here, then you have to suspect an obstruction of the inferior or superior vena cava. In this particular patient, it was asymptomatic, was just a congenital interruption of the inferior vena cava with azygos continuation. So to summarize, what to look for in the aortic node: double contour, suspect the mediastinal mass, figure of three, coartation with a rare pseudo-coartation, increased size, definitely an aneurysm. If you see a large aortic nipple, suspect a venous obstruction of the systemic veins, either the superior or the inferior vena cava. A final word about aortic calcification. And when I say aortic calcification, is because of the arteries of the mediastinum, only the aorta calcifies, because the pulmonary artery doesn't calcify, very rarely calcifies, and then is only seen in CT. So when you say aortic calcification, you think of atherosclerosis, and this is normal in an old person, except when the person is young. This is not normal in a young person. This is clearly abnormal. And if the patient has not any hypercalcemic state, you should suspect an aortitis and do the pertinent studies. Here is the CT of this patient with abundant calcification in the descending aorta, mark narrowing here, thickened wall, and this obviously was an aortitis who was diagnosed as Takayasu disease. Well, to finalize and summarize, again, we have a very limited semiology there, but it's very important. In the mediastinum basic checklist, we had to look for convexity of the ascending aorta, which may indicate important diseases. Look at the azygos arch, and for that, azygos arch is over here. For that, go to the diploma fist disease. On the left side, look at the aortic knob, and look also at the convexity of the main pulmonary artery. Again, may these discrete abnormalities may be very important. They are maybe not very obvious, but again, may portend important diseases. And also here, look at the AP window and go to diploma 144, and I will find all the information about that. And with this, I'm finished. Sorry, because this is a sort of a boring lecture, but it has to be done because you had to know about it. And I hope you will come back for the next webinar. Thank you very much for your attention.